Welcome to today's webinar about eMMC longevity consideration for embedded Linux products. Before I start and make the introduction, I like to get a few organizational stuff figured out. So first, there is a chat. So if you only have technical problem, you cannot hear us or any other questions, please feel free to put that in the chat. We're doing a recording, and the recording will be available a few days after the webinar, and we will send you a link. Also, at the end of the webinar, we will have a live Q&A, and you can put your question in the chat window. There's a Q&A window, and you can already put them in while we are presenting, and we will pick them up at the end and answer them live. With that out of the way, I would like to get started with some introductions. So today, most of the webinar will be presented by John. He's a director of engineering at Kingston, and he has over 20 years of experience in that business. Myself, I'm Daniel. I'm the chief marketing officer for Toradex. I'm like 17 years or so with Toradex, and I'm located here in Switzerland. Before we really focus on the eMMC, just a few words about who is Toradex, what's Toradex doing, in case you don't know yet. So Toradex, we really, our main focus is to make embedded computing easy, like the new fancy flash chips from Kingston or SOCs. We make them easier to use, easier to integrate in your product. How we do that is with reliable ARM system on modules. Also, Toradex focuses heavily on software. So we also have an embedded Linux IoT solution, which will I show a little bit later, called Torizon. So more than 85% of our engineers are actually software engineers. We try to achieve the lowest cost of ownership for you. That doesn't mean that our modules may be the cheapest when you buy them, but if you consider how long it takes you to develop with it, and then you have it in the field, you want to maintain it for many years, if you all consider that, we think we can provide you the best value. Also, Toradex is very famous for our industry-leading support. We have a developer center with over 800 articles. We're doing these webinars. We're having blogs. And you can see here on the world map, we have local FOEs all over the world to help you with your products. So I think it's also very interesting to know a little bit who is our main target customer, so you understand why we do certain things in a certain way. So our top markets are industrial automation and healthcare, transportation, test and measurement, and smart city. And you can see they all have together that reliability is important and that a failed eMMC could lead to high costs. The volume of our customers are typically from a few hundred to a few 10,000 pieces per project. That's where the system on module make a lot of sense. We also have customer lower volume, and we have few customer doing higher volumes per year. So to give you an overview about our product portfolio, most of that is NXP i.MX products at the moment. We are also one of the very few platinum partners from NXP. But you can also see here we have the newest product is with a TI. It's a Verdin AM62 targeting at a low cost application, so very cost effective. And you see also here on the right side our focus on software with Linux, our main focus. And then we have other software such as Android and QNX provided by our partners. And then here, Torizon. So Torizon is really a system which allows you to simplify the development and maintenance of your embedded Linux devices. And it helps you on different areas. So as a developer, you get a pre-built Linux image with a Yocto. It's built with Yocto, but you don't need to know all about the Yocto. You can really easily configure it yourself. We have a lot of partners like Qt, which provides you a UI framework. We have machine learning database. You can pull in very easily and get started. It's integrated with Visual Studio. So if you know how to develop on a desktop PC, it will be very easy. Then we provide a very secure and reliable way to update your systems in the field. The underlying security architecture is called Optane and is very, very secure. It's designed against state actor attacks. And then you also have a way back, and we will see that a little bit later. So, for example, you could monitor the wear of your flash, basically out of the box. You can also monitor other things in the system. And if you have any trouble, there is a way to remotely access your devices in a secure way. And of course, what you learn there, you can provide to your developers to produce better products, to improve your products over time, to patch security issues, and so on. But I think that's enough about Toradex. So I would like to hand over to John, and we really dive deeper in the main topic of the webinar, the eMMC reliability considerations.
Good morning, everybody. Today, this is John Terpening. I am the Director of Engineering for our embedded group in North America. And our embedded products cover a variety of solder down storage and DRAM. So today we're going to be discussing mostly managed NAND, what eMMC does, and some of the options for configuring our eMMC, some of the base options. So with that, let's start out with a poll question. And there is a poll. Do you use, if you have an application already, do you use eMMC as your only flash storage? Or are you looking at or considering other type of devices? So I'll give you about 30 seconds if anyone wants to participate in that poll, and we'll look at the results. Okay. And a lot of eMMC users have, and we'll be talking more detail today just about what managed NAND is and some of the considerations around that. So let's move on with the presentation here. Okay, so basically NAND itself is not a simple read-write device that is non-volatile, where you can just simply, like a lot of memory, just overwrite it. It actually has specific things. It's got pages, and that's the program unit. You have blocks that have to be managed, and that's your erase unit. And there are other things to consider, such as wear leveling, performance, data reliability, error control, and that has quite a bit of an algorithm that have to be managed. Back in the old days, there was raw NAND solutions, and all this was done by the host processor. So you can see here on the diagram on the left, you had the block management, garbage collection, error control, wear leveling. Again, all done at the host processor side, and that would interface with the NAND. That created some problems because as the NAND got more complex and higher capacity, these algorithms became more complex and was a lot of overhead for the host processor. It also required adjustments to these algorithms to switch from different manufacturers or different generations. So the trend back in 2009, when the eMMC standard came out, basically there was the MMC card standard. JEDEC took the standard over. JEDEC is a standards organization, put the little E in front of it, and made it a soldered down standard for managed NAND. So with that, the goal was to take all those management algorithms, introduce a eMMC controller on the along with the NAND flash on a single chip, and move those algorithms over. So all this now is done transparent to the host, and alleviates the host of these complexities. So we'll talk a little bit more by managed NAND. What do we mean? We mean error control. So there's ECC on the flash. That is every generation that has to get stronger and stronger. It's actually a pretty extensive amount of error control. There's algorithms, for instance, such as read retry. If your error gets so high when you read a page that you can't recover it, even with the ECC, there are algorithms where they can move the goalposts around, the thresholds, basically, and try to recover error bits that way. There's a need to refresh the blocks. The data itself can get corrupted. And when it gets corrupted due to either data retention issues or due to another mechanism known as read disturb, these error bits can accumulate within a block. So we would monitor that when we see it getting close to the ECC capability up to around 75%. We would do a page refresh and scrub the errors out. So there's that management. Also, just with a high read count on a block, which can also cause errors, we would monitor that read count and do a refresh. There is eMMC provides a CRC scheme for data that's in transit, so the host can validate that it received a good data and vice versa. There's longevity algorithms, and we'll talk more about that, dynamic and static wear leveling. There is a need to recover blocks as they get unmapped, erase them, and put them in a pool for future use. And we'll also talk a bit about the mapping schemes and address translation table. So starting basically with the NAND flash, the smallest unit, the base unit there, is the page. And typically today, in most of the generations across most manufacturers, these pages are 16 K bytes in size. So this page is our program unit. You have to program the entire page at once. You can't just program particular bytes. Once that page is programmed, you can't just overwrite it as well. It's a one-time operation until that entire block is erased. So with that, you have multiple pages stored into a block, a NAND block, and that block is our erase unit. So you can't erase individual pages. You have to actually erase at the block level. Within the eMMC and other storage devices that are managed, we always maintain extra blocks, sometimes referred to as spare blocks. But basically, all blocks are used. There's a spare pool of blocks that are erased, ready to be allocated for future writes. And so that spare pool blocks will come in and out of that spare pool. And typically that can be about 10%, sometimes a little more, sometimes a little less, depending on what the design goals are. Last, there's our planes. Some of the smaller devices are single plane. You get into larger devices that are dual or four plane. And this basically functionally divides the NAND into separate functional planes. So concurrent operations can be performed for boosting performance. Okay, so as we talked about, program and reads all happen at that page level. Again, you can't overwrite a page. The block has to be erased with all the pages in it. So our erase unit is up at the block level. NAND flash data representation. So how is data coded into the NAND? This is done by energy levels. So back in the early days of NAND, you had what was termed SLC, or single level cell NAND. And so the effectively you have two energy levels to represent a one and a zero, so a single threshold. Later on, as the technology advanced, they learned to put four energy levels to represent two bits in a cell. So we were able to achieve higher density by dividing those cells up into more energy levels. So it takes four energy levels to represent two bits, such as a 00011011. So each of those would represent two bits at a time. Same can be done to get three bits in there, right? That's eight energy levels to represent three binary bits in a cell. And even now today, we're starting to see some QLC coming in to represent 16 levels to get four bits. Notice, and I'll show kind of what that looks like. Most of eMMC, the older generation, is MLC. Today, there's a lot of the higher capacity 3D NAND that has gone towards a TLC configuration. And we sometimes do what's called pseudo-SLC. So pseudo-SLC is where you can take something that is natively MLC or TLC and convert it back to a single level cell storage device. That reduces the capacity accordingly. So in other words, if you're going MLC to pseudo SLC, you're going to be giving up two bits for a single bit. So you have the capacity, but you gain some of the benefits from SLC. And same with likewise with TLC, where you have three bits per cell. If you convert that to a pseudo SLC device, you're losing 66%, two-thirds of your your capacity, but again, you will gain improved endurance and write performance as well. Sometimes there's also a pseudo-MLC where you can take a TLC 3-bit per cell and convert it to 2-bit per cell. Not very common, but it's been done. So graphically, how does that look? We talked about entire pages being programmed. So all the bits in that page are programmed at once in one operation. So you wind up with distributions of what a 1 and a 0 is. So for the SLC, you can see in the middle of this graph, there's a voltage threshold there. It has a better signal to noise in a sense. So we're able to program this faster, and it also will have better endurance since we have a larger separation between what a 1 is and what a 0 is. When we start to divide that up in MLC, we lose that margin. But we gain capacity. And then, of course, TLC, even more. So we gain another bit capacity, but we really have to slice that cell into four extra energy levels, double the amount of energy levels there. Okay, so we have another poll question. The question here is, how long are your devices running in the field? Does your application have a short life? Do you expect it more than 5 years, 10 years? What's your lifetime expectancy of your device operating in the field? And we'll give you about 30 seconds if those want to participate. Okay, so looks like we got up to 10 years, and that's very consistent with what I've heard too. So a lot of our products being embedded, they want to have this definite longevity. The part has to go out there. A lot of our customers are infrastructure where they're running 24/7 for a very long time. So endurance, that's our next topic, is going to be very relevant to this and how that's achieved. Okay, so on that subject of NAND flash endurance, like any media, you can write and erase to it so many times. Every time you do, whether it's a piece of paper and you're erasing it, magnetic storage or NAND flash storage, the quality goes down. The ability to retain data and read it back is reduced every cycle. And eventually that hits what we're calling the endurance limit, where that quality is below what we consider acceptable, what's considered acceptable in the industry. And at that point, the device is end of life. So this is a gradual decline towards that endurance limit. And just because you hit it doesn't mean the device will stop functioning. We've seen devices come back from the field that have been where the endurance limit sometimes exceeded 2-3 times and even higher than what it was rated at. A lot of that depends on environmental conditions as to when they're going to see actual data corruption. But that's the end result usually is as you exceed that endurance limit, the data is more susceptible to corruption. So how does that relate to SLC? Again, we talked about that margin there with a single bit per cell. SLC has the highest. Typically, that's 10 times higher than its native mode. It can even be higher than that relative to the endurance. So if you want long life, SLC is something to consider. Also, increasing the capacity of the device is another thing to consider because we're going to be throwing in more blocks and spreading that wear across more blocks. So there are two ways to achieve a longer life part. First would be look at shifting it towards the SLC. The second will be increasing the capacity. MLC, typically we'll see about 3,000 cycles across the industry for the last generation of MLC. MLC is fairly legacy nowadays, but it's still supported. And then with the TLC, the current technology now is all a 3D structure, 3D NAND. We're at the fifth generation of that, even going into the sixth generation. And all that is a TLC configuration. So that is still 3,000 cycles. We can get that up to sometimes 10x, 30,000 cycles in a pseudo-SLC mode as well. So So most of these devices will go to, when put in pseudo-SLC, we can get 10x of their native endurance, the 3,000 in their native mode, and 30,000 or higher, depending on the generation and technology endurance in pseudo-SLC. And again, overall, over time, over the history of NAND, every time that geometry shrink has happened, the endurance has been reduced in the device, since those NAND cells get smaller as that node shrinks. That's been countered with larger error control to try to recover that. And again, the error control algorithms are much more sophisticated than what they were a decade ago. With that said, wear leveling is very important. Wear leveling is a algorithm to spread the wear evenly across the device. We'll talk about that, as that's one of the more central managed algorithms for managed NAND that the eMMC will handle. Okay, so the wear leveling is basically is done by using a address translation table. So the eMMC is accessed in 512 byte sectors. So every address you apply to an eMMC device gives you access to that 512 byte sector. That's what we refer to as a logical address. These logical addresses are grouped together. These 512 byte sectors are grouped together to get mapped to a particular page, a physical address. However, that is not a static relationship. That is adjusted for wear leveling and performance. And that's done with a address translation table. So what we have here is a very simplified example of what that table looks like. Again, it is simplified, but on the left column here of this table, we have a sector address. And since our pages are 16K bytes in size, that gets you 32 sectors. So you can see the logical addresses are, the sectors are clumped together in 32, a quantity of 32 in each group. And those are mapped to a physical location in the table on the right side. So we have a block, a particular block number, and a page within that block that forms that relationship. So if we want to modify something, say, in there, we got a sector 64 through 95. The host would write the new data. The controller would read that page, those group of sectors, modify the sectors that need to get updated, then unmap it, in the address translation table and map it to a erased page, a page that is in erased state. So that produces a new relationship between those sectors and a new block and page within that block. The original block gets most of its pages unmapped. And when it gets most of its pages unmapped, it hits a threshold where an algorithm known as garbage collection will be triggered. And what that does is it removes the remaining pages that are still in use over to a fresh block. And then that block is erased and placed in a pool for future use. So this allows us to do wear leveling, and we have two main algorithms. The first is dynamic wear leveling, and this is executed during all writes. So every time we grab a new page, every time we allocate a block for writes, for future writes and current writes, we go to that pool of erased blocks and we get the one with the lowest age, and we use always the lowest age block and allocate that for future writes. And so that way we're balancing the wear out across all those blocks in the pool. So that forms dynamic wear leveling, and that happens through what we just described. The other type of wear leveling is known as static wear leveling. And this is needed because you're going to have addresses, locations that don't get modified frequently or at all. They become mostly read-only. And so as a result, the blocks that those locations are mapped to are static and don't age. So what you see over time is dynamic wear leveling happening on these dynamic blocks, where the static blocks just stay at the same age. eventually that gets to a threshold, a differential that's high enough that triggers a static wear leveling algorithm. And so what that does is it, we take those blocks and all the data that's mapped to it and copy it over into a block from the pool. But this time we get the oldest block, the block with the highest erase count, out of the pool and map our static data to that. And then the static block gets erased, garbage collected in a sense, and put back in the pool. And since it is at a young stage, a low erase count, it'll get used for dynamic wear leveling and catch up to the other blocks. So between these two algorithms, it balances out all the wear across the NAND. So it wears evenly and maximizes the device life. So on that, we have a video on our website. If you go to kingston.com and navigate to our embedded, you will see a video here, which kind of explains an animation of wear leveling. It's also in this link. And what I will do is actually run that here. Okay, so I believe you can see this now. So what this was is we did this in our lab. We took a 16 gigabyte device. It was at a brand new array state, and each one of these dots down on the bottom here represent a block age. So the erase count, the age, is on the y-axis, and then the block number for the 16 gig device is all the way here. So these are physical blocks. We then applied a random write load. Some blocks got written to more than others, and then on regular basis we stopped. Interrogated the controller, got the block age, and then continued to run and repeat this cycle. So as we got through this whole cycle, we would then animate this data to show the actual wear leveling in progress. So I'm going to run this video here, and I'll stop it and pause it once it kicks off here. So what you're seeing here is the blocks are aging. And I'm going to pause it for a second to explain a little more. These blocks are your dynamic blocks, and they're all wear leveling fairly evenly, right? Down on this end here, you have this device was a native mode TLC device, so mostly TLC. However, for the firmware, address translation table, other system level stuff, we store that in an SLC area that the user can't see. So this is the SLC blocks. So since they're 10 times the endurance, you'll see them age at a faster rate. But this is where the firmware is stored. And so that's why you'll see the difference. Down here on the starting line, you see the blocks that are not aging at all. And these are the static blocks. So eventually you'll see static wear leveling kick in. And so I'm going to run it from here again. And right about now, the static wear leveling kicks in. So I'll stop it here. Down near the end here, 650, 700, you can see the blocks are starting to come off the line. That's static wear leveling happening. And so you'll see more and more of these blocks come off the line, while other blocks will, on the dynamic level, will stop aging. You know, the top, they'll stop aging and freeze, while these static blocks that were once static become dynamic and age now at a faster rate to catch up. And so this will continue, and this is now both algorithms are fully active, both dynamic and static wear leveling as we write to this device. And that creates this cloud. And our threshold here, I believe, is about 50 array cycles between max and min. So once that falls in line, you'll see this cloud continue to age up till end of life of the device. We're not going to go that long, but at least up to the 100 array cycles. That's still very early in the life of the part. So that is what wear leveling looks like. And again, that video you can find with full explanation on our website at the link that was provided. So there's a couple things you can do to monitor life. The JEDEC standard, we have a, inside the controller, there is a register that can be interrogated by the host system. That's a 512 byte register. Known as the extended CSD. Location 268 and 269 provide NAND flash wear to the nearest 10%. So that's kind of standard across most manufacturers. And so by reading that, you can see at least 10% where that device is in its life cycle, in its age life cycle. There's also proprietary vendor commands that can be issued directly to our controller to get average block, the exact precise average block age, erase count that is, the max, the min, and all the individual blocks that can be obtained. And then Toradex also has tools that Daniel will demonstrate here that access various aspects of the device, including the age. Last, there is a Linux MMC util library file out there that can be used at the application level to gain access to both the proprietary commands that we can provide or to the extended CSD. Let's see, with that, Daniel, I think you had a demonstration. We can turn over to you.
Yes, and thanks a lot. Let me share my screen here. So I pre-recorded it to make it a little bit easier here. But here you can see our Torizon online platform. As you maybe remember, at the beginning, I showed this platform, which is an embedded Linux system, which we already integrate tools to read the health of the flash. And it's very easy for you. Then also make an account for free. You can get started and have an online visibility of the devices, where you can do updates, you can remote access, but you also get information about the flash. And we have here some test devices where we wear out the flash on purpose to show you a little bit how that is. So you see here a little bit how this works. And I zoom here a little bit forward, which I like here. So maybe stop it short. So here you can see our dashboards for the device. Monitoring, and you can actually monitoring like memory usage, CPU load, temperature, which can also impact the flash life. So you get a good visibility how your customer use the product, and to see if you have any problem in the field, if maybe devices overheat or your end customer put there somewhere where they shouldn't. So it's a very crucial to provide the best possible reliability. And then here you can see on the bottom left, the life cycle estimate from these MLC devices. So you see these numbers, it's a little bit encoded, but it's percentage of the life. You can also get warnings from the firmware where you are. And there are some very high profile cases in the automotive industry and other industry where people wear flash out by accident. They maybe locked too much, or they forgot to disable some debug stuff, which may be locked more on the eMMC as they want. It's also not so trivial to just estimate how much really get written on the flash. And here you can real time see that if you have pilot runs or early in development, you can see how your programs behave, how other software behaves on the system, and you get the trend. And it's very easy to estimate how long it will take until the flash wear out. Also, it could be that you do an update and maybe somehow there are, you know, the rights to the flashes change. So you could monitor that, take action. If you maybe have, you know, you maybe write too much, you could adjust the software. And then with Torizon, you also have a very, very reliable and secure way to deploy that to your device to improve the situation. So I think, and that works very well. And then Kingston has this proprietary command where you can get a very high resolution and a lot of information about the flash. With that, I would hand back to John.
Yeah, thanks, Daniel. So one last thing to close on this subject is that on our website, we do have a few other app notes and as well as videos to discuss how to reduce the age of the device, or at least not age it as fast as Daniel mentioned, host side behavior has a lot to do with how the device ages. So it's not just the amount of data you write, but how you write it. Larger sequential chunks tend to be more friendly to the NAND because we have to program the entire page at a time. So if you're writing individual sectors, each time you do that, it writes an entire page. So it can age the device faster. That's what we call write amplification. It's outside the scope of our presentation here, but I would direct you to our website to learn more. And also, we're here for questions on that through emails and one-on-one discussions. So with that said, we have free-based firmwares to optimize for your application. And the most common for the embedded world, we have one that we call a native mode. And so that's typically the devices are all going to be MLC for the smaller capacity or 3D NAND when you get up 16. Sometimes there's MLC there. 32 gig and up tends to be TLC. And newer generations go into the higher capacities. So there is a feature, and we call this dynamic SLC. That's a proprietary term. But basically, you're in the native mode TLC. You see the full capacity of the TLC or the MLC device. But internally, the controller can put it in an SLC mode. And it would do that to boost the performance. So you can have this dynamic SLC feature on where you're seeing SLC-like write performance. It programs much faster. And that's great until you start to run out of space. And as you run out of storage space, because you're writing more to it, the host controller will start converting those pseudo-SLC blocks back to their native mode, be it TLC or MLC. And so you'll see the performance drop off when it does that. So for most embedded applications, having just good enough performance and consistent performance across the life of the part is what needs to be achieved. A vending machine, a robotic vacuum cleaner is not going to work any faster or any better if the peak performance is higher on the storage device. It just needs a minimum performance level and more consistent. And that mode, that native mode with the dynamic SLC off, offers that consistent performance and longer life than dynamic SLC on. So you would typically, if you need all the capacity but don't need that peak performance, you would go with that default. The other is native mode with dynamic SLC on. And this usually, let's say you got a user on the other end of it where they will notice a performance difference. So in those cases where you want to offer them as much capacity as possible, but take advantage of that unused capacity while it is unused, you can get SLC-like performance with that native mode dynamic SLC on. The one disadvantage is when you're in that dynamic SLC mode, you're accruing array cycles faster since you have less blocks, less space to wear across. So it can age it faster, and then eventually it converts back to that native mode, and it brings all those array counts with it. So it can shorten the life of the part over dynamic SLC off. And then last, we have the SLC mode, the pseudo-SLC mode, where the device is in that mode 100% of the time. So for instance, our 4-gig MLC device in pseudo-SLC, we represent it as a 4-gig device configured that way, but you'll have actually 2-gig of usable space. But with that, you gain the endurance, 10x endurance, and you gain higher write speed, significantly higher write speed. So if you need either of those, pseudo SLC is the way to go. There are many other possible configurations. If your application requires some other customization or you find you can't achieve it with this, you can contact us and we can discuss how to get there. And so there is an app note as well on our website. So again, when you go to this address here, you can just go to kingston.com and then select the embedded industrial embedded computing section. Down on the bottom of the page, we have a few app notes and on, under the eMMC, and there's a firmware configuration application note also at this link, which talks about those three base configurations. Okay, with that, we have another poll here. Just pulling, as I talked about the different applications, some people really find write performance is critical. Maybe they're storing video. Others, it's operating a vending machine. Another, they want more reliability out of it. So here's the question, is the eMMC speed an evaluation criteria for your embedded system? And we'll give 30 seconds for those that want to participate. Okay, and the results are in. Yeah, and that seems, again, always consistent. Some require that. And what I would say is if you need the capacity, again, consider maybe looking at the dynamic SLC on. You know, that'll give you, that'll maintain your capacity, but give you some peak performance. And otherwise, if you really need the performance all the time, consider pseudo-SLC, because that will give you faster write performance. Read performance is high and consistent across all different firmwares. Okay, that concludes sort of the technical portion of my presentation. The rest is a bit about the market and a couple of other technologies in coming in the market and some of our advantage at Kingston. So managed NAND solution, eMMC was the primary. That's been out since 2009. UFS is another standard that you'll hear about sometimes coming on, and is getting promoted a lot. However, the kind of the differences make eMMC somewhat more favorable for most embedded applications. So, talking about those differences, eMMC basically is a backwards compatible standard. It's friendly to lower capacities and it's cost effective. So for most embedded solutions, where you want, you don't need large capacity, most of the SOCs out in the market will support eMMC and only eMMC for that that mass storage. The other benefit is that backwards compatibility. So a 5.1 version of eMMC supports all prior revisions. No functionality is ever removed from the standard, as well as the physical interface. The newer revs will always support the prior physical interfaces. So you're guaranteed compatibility. Even if your system, let's say, supports only 4.5, you can drop the 5.1 in there. Speed limitations, obviously, in the lower capacities, your bottleneck is at the flash. How fast you can program and read data out of that flash. The performance goes up with higher capacity devices, and eventually will saturate the throughput of that eMMC bus. So at higher capacities, eMMC can present a performance limitation. And we're talking at 128 gig, 256 gig, some of these higher capacities there. But at the lower capacities, the bottleneck is really at the flash. With that, you have UFS standard. It's also a JEDEC standard. And this came out and it's built on what's known as a MIPI M5 interface. So that physical interface is used very common across the mobile device market. So the stuff that's in your cell phones, your tablets, that a lot of that works with the M5. So UFS is built on top of that. It services that market mostly. And so backwards compatibility is not an objective of it. So again, most often eMMC better fits in that embedded market. We do have some customers that are selecting SOCs that use UFS. Our benefit there is we will continue to support some of these UFS revisions as they become legacy into the future. So with that, Let me explain this slide. So it's kind of a timeline of the technologies and the different markets they're servicing. So back in 2010, 2009, you had the eMMC standard come out. UFS was there, but the adoption was almost 100% on eMMC, on your mobile applications, which is the higher big arrow, and then embedded applications. So both mobile and embedded were leveraging the same technology, the same devices. In those days, 4 or 8 gig, these low capacities were cutting edge capacities, cutting edge technology, because the die capacities were smaller. Fast forward to today, and if you're looking to use the current generation of 3D NAND technology, the smallest device you can get is a 64 gigabyte device. Anything below that uses prior generations of 3D NAND, or we get down to the 2D MLC NAND as well, the planar NAND. So that's in the lower capacities. So those, that technology is becoming very legacy. Our advantage is that some of the main, there's only, you know, four main foundries globally that produce the bulk of the world's flash and DRAM. And our advantage is Kingston's size, our buying power, because we have not just embedded, but our enterprise SSD storage, and in our USB flash drives and cards, we are a very large consumer of both NAND and DRAM. And with that, we have agreements and buying power, a lot of leverage with those foundries to get support. And then we can provide that support to you along with the low cost. And even in markets where the NAND becomes, obtaining it gets very constrained, we can still support that. Again, on the embedded, 4 or 8 gig tends to be a very popular capacity, 16 gig, these lower capacities. UFS is really not suitable for that. eMMC is the best way to go. For the mobile applications, it's almost 100% changed over to UFS. And that's where a lot of the foundries want to focus, is up on this 128, 256, 512 gigabyte UFS solutions for your cell phones, your smartphones and your tablets. That's going to track with Moore's law. Some embedded applications, again, will use UFS. Kingston's a good choice for that because we will able to continue to support them even as those capacities and generations of UFS become legacy. And you don't necessarily gain the backwards compatibility, so they can't necessarily just drop in the next rev of UFS because it may be incompatible. So therefore, Kingston becomes a choice. So what are we? We are that large purchase, acquiring quite a bit of flash, and we can aggregate all of that raw material in our buying power to ensure that we can support the market in any market condition at a very cost-effective price. We are the largest third-party memory manufacturer, or memory module and memory product manufacturer there. We have and maintain all product development ourselves, all the way down through assembly, test, package design. We have very extensive system validation, both around the globe in different labs, including my lab out here in Southern California. We have hundreds and hundreds of systems of representing the market, all the different SOC manufacturers. And we do many weeks, sometimes well over a month of validation before we're able to finally release a product to the market. That ensures that we have a very low chance, even on a new product that gets out there, of finding compatibility issues across there. On that note, should we find an application that has a compatibility issue and needs an adjustment in the firmware to make it work, we lock all our firmware and BOM. So what you qualify, what you order, is as long as you order that part number, you'll continue to get the exact same thing. To address any other application where we have that compatibility issue, we will generate a firmware branch and a new part number to serve that application. So again, that's a very tight control, which is, I think, a requirement for the embedded products market. On that last part, we have several FAEs to answer any questions you have through email. And that can also be through a WebEx or a phone call, one-on-one, to get all your questions answered and get you through that design phase. We want to ensure you have the right configuration and right device and to meet all your requirements. We have an ability to do content load, so we could preload content on a device, kind of eases manufacturing in some cases. And we, again, as I talked about, have the multiple firmwares along with all the validation. So with that, you get longevity. You have a design. Not only will the product run for a long time, long life cycle, but we will be able to continue to support that product, that bill of material with eMMC. Okay, and I think I got ahead of myself and already covered some of these points here, but these are our advantages. Again, we'll continue to maintain support for some of these lower capacities that are very embedded friendly, even as some of the foundries drop off and focus on the higher capacities and UFS. And then this is our closing slide. We're a global company. We've been in business. Kingston has been in business for 36 years. We again have all the support you need, and you can contact us with any questions. And I will open that up to the Q&A session.
Thanks so much, John. With that, we go to the Q&A, and I see a lot of questions, so maybe up front, in case we cannot cover your question here live, we will try to follow up via email. But let's just dive into. I think this one is for John. Regarding data retention, is it enough to power eMMC devices from time to time, or are real read accesses required to refresh data, or is this picture completely wrong? So I think it's data retention value the device is off, basically.
Yeah, that's a very good question. And so data retention is a function of just a little background on that. When you write to a device, whether it's eMMC or a cave wall, over time that data fades and gets to a point where it can't be recovered. And so that period of time is our data retention time. With that, regarding NAND, the ability for the NAND to maintain data, including with the error correction, that is data that can be recovered without error, is a measured as data retention. Usually that's about 10 years for a new device, but that is a function of how many array cycles on that device. So a device at the endurance limit, that data retention goes down to typically about 1 year when you're under 40 C. So that brings in temperature. Temperature is the other factor that will reduce data retention, as well as we mentioned read to serves. So if your device is old and in a hot environment, you're above 40, you're going to be less than a year at end of life. And again, at a new device, it's typically about 10 years data retention. Powering it up will not be enough. What you have to do is read it to trigger those refresh algorithms. So I think I mentioned early on there that every time you read a page, we correct the errors. The errors are corrected by the controller, and the clean data is passed on to you. The original data still exists in the NAND flash. When we see that error rate get up to 75% of the correction capability of the ECC, we'll also flag it, and that entire block, all the other pages within that block, get scrubbed with errors and programmed back to a new block while that block gets recycled and used for future. So again, to trigger that refresh operation, you would have to at least read a few pages within that block to for the controller to discover the situation.
Okay. Thanks so much. That's an interesting question. I also maybe just to the time we will run out. We maybe try to go a little bit over the time, But if you have to leave, again, we will record it. We will share it. So in worst case, you can also maybe find your question answered in the recording. So with that, pick another one here. For an industrial grade product with 20 years lifespan, requirement and storage usage size of about 512 megabytes, is NOR flash a better choice than eMMC?
So for the lower capacities, you know, if you can use NOR, you would have to look at the, I would refer you to the specific manufacturer, but for those low capacities, below 512 meg, consider cost, consider how much you're writing to it, how you're writing to it, some of the other factors. But NOR may be a good way to go. Obviously, in terms of support, eMMC will be there for a long time. You get larger capacity, and that the larger capacity can still be used for wear leveling. So let's say you only need to use 1 gig or 512 meg of your eMMC device. You can put a partition on there that is that size, and it will still use all that NAND. All that NAND will be allocated wear leveled. So what effectively that does is it gets you a longer life device. So you would really have to weigh all those factors, cost, what's the life of your product, how long you're going to support it. But, you know, definitely in the higher capacities above a gigabyte, eMMC is going to make sense and be the default choice. When you get into those lower, you have to consider, does a NOR flash meet your requirements? Is it cost effective? Or does it make sense to use eMMC? And again, there's no penalty on eMMC just to use a few sectors. If you only use one 512 byte sector, it'll still wear level across the entire device.
Yeah, I mean, I also can show that from my side. I mean, we have many customers doing medical and industrial applications, which have exactly that basically use case. And we definitely see that many of them are able to use high quality eMMCs like, you know, that with the monitoring and the right implementation. But they would, of course, not maybe put just 512 megabyte on. They would put 4 gigabyte, 8 gigabyte, so they can do better wear leveling over this solution. But I think John mentioned many criteria you can use. Then maybe another question. There are several ones. They're all similar. They're asking about ERISE cycles. I know you mentioned it, but maybe you can short go over the typical ERISE cycles again.
Yeah. So, you know, a lot of what's going to determine the life, you know, when that product reaches the endurance, when does it reach end of life? And that is not just the volume of data you write, but how you write to it. So we do have some presentations on our website I would refer you to. You can also contact us more if we don't get it answered here. But ideally, you want to write longer sequential writes. Some applications that do single sector logging, if you just write one single sector and not a sequence of sectors, you will trigger a full page program. So that amplifies the writes and can cause a write amplification error of 32, since you have 32 sectors in there. So people are sometimes surprised at how much they've written because they didn't think they wrote that much. But a lot of small writes can be a penalty by amplification. So understanding that is important, understanding how much data logging. We've had customers send stuff back and they didn't realize that there's a whole bunch of logging going on, debug logs going on in the background from their code that had triggered very fast age. And with that, Tordex's tools there would be an excellent way to monitor that out in the field. The other thing I will say is in the lab, when you're validating your device, do it with an actual workload or a workload that represents your daily usage. You can accelerate the workload, but you want to try to mimic that right behavior. And that will tell you how fast the device is aging. So you could even remove a chip, send it to us, we can do an analysis on it, or you can use the vendor commands to access the device and find out how much you've written to it and how that workload has affected the age.
Good. Then there are several questions. They're similar about the behavior on power cuts. So cache, data loss, lifetime, just so sudden power loss effects on eMMC.
Sure. So I mentioned in our lab, we do very extensive testing, and one of that is sudden power loss. So we have large racks of systems. Anytime there's an adjustment to firmware or new product, it goes through this gauntlet of testing, and that is sudden power loss. So the eMMC is very robust against that. If power loss happens during a write, one of the things that happens is the last thing that occurs is updating that address translation table. So if a power loss happens during that program process, what happens is the device will revert back to the previous data that was there. So you would lose your current data, obviously, because it wasn't programmed in. But the system still maintains stability because of it's mapped to the previous. There's also redundancy built into most of the file systems, ext4, ext3, where there are protections to recover from power failures. For that. But as far as corruption happening at the device level, it is extremely remote. Pseudo-SLC mode is even less likely to happen. So it's a very remote case that you will have a corrupt device from sudden power loss.
Okay, good. Thanks a lot. Also, I can add here that Torrex itself, we also do a lot of testing of eMMC and cases like sudden random power cuts, and so to really lower the risk there. And of course, we also provide easy ways to power your device down more gracefully if you have this chance to do that. Then maybe one or two questions more. Do read a page many times also reduce life cycle? So how does the read affect the life of a flash?
So read does not affect directly affect endurance. So you're not really aging the device through a read. What it can do is create a read disturb mechanism in the NAND. So every time you read from a page, that page or other pages within that block can get disturbed. So error bits can appear, and they are covered by the ECC algorithm. So what we do is we track the number of reads to a block, and should that count hit a threshold, we will execute a block refresh where all the errors will be scrubbed and programmed back to a fresh block. Now, that's a background operation that creates a little bit of WAF, but it would take an awful lot of reading to trigger that. So indirectly, there's a little bit of age associated with that since we're copying data over, but it's insignificant.
Okay. Can we choose the firmware on the fly, or do we need to choose it when we're ordering an eMMC part?
That's chosen up front. And so the dynamic SLC on or off, that's an upfront choice. Pseudo-SLC, we have a configuration where the device is pre-configured into that mode. You can convert either of those native modes to a pseudo-SLC mode by using the eMMC partition attributes, known as enhanced partition attributes. So that can set all or a portion of the main user partition into pseudo-SLC mode, what they call referred to as enhanced mode in the eMMC spec. So the problem is if you do it in the field or when you do it, it is a one-time operation and all your data on the device is wiped out. So it doesn't really make much sense to do it in the field since it's going to wipe out your data, and it's a one-time operation. So effectively, everything's done at the time of purchase. Most of our customers just pre-purchase the device in that mode. And it's the same cost, by the way, for regardless of the firmware option you choose.
Great. Yeah, maybe also add short how Toradex specific. So we normally use the default mode, and then, but we have customer which when then they're, you know, programming the flash the first time, they would use this enhanced mode for this SLC mode of parts of the flash or the whole thing. If you really need some of the firmware, we are able to build BTOs, like build to order, where you can request, you know, special thing. We also can do other things for you. It's normally interesting if your volume's a little bit higher, you know, from a few thousand on, then we can, you know, get you also our modules equipped with these Kingston devices. Good. I let's pick maybe one more, and then you know, we will follow up. But there are many questions here. It's very nice to see you guys engaging here. How big internal controller's cache if NAND's quite big? So for like rephrase it short, for big NAND flashes, like, you know, 256 gigabyte or bigger, how big is the flash? And he asked that if you need to do anything in particular to rewrite or do anything to avoid losses, data losses.
So there's nothing you have to do to avoid data losses, provided once that write completes, once the eMMC busy flag goes to non-busy, goes off, that data has been committed and is safe. Very remote chance of corruption there. The caching algorithm, we can protect that. There is a bit in the extended CSD known as write reliability that can improve the write reliability of the device for sudden power loss. Again, in most cases, we do extensive testing with that off, and we're unable in our labs after, you know, thousands of power cycles to trigger a data corruption right in the middle of writes or during other times. So, you know, again, I would say you're very safe there from data corruption. If you want to be extra cautious, you can set that write reliability bit. That may cost you a little bit in performance, or what you can do is use pseudo-SLC mode.
Good. Yeah, I think I will cut it here. I also a little bit respect from, you know, from you guys, but again, make sure you check out the recording. You can share it, and I think there's a lot. There are actually some more questions about wear leveling. So if you came late, I also can really recommend the video Kingston produced, which really shows you the difference from dynamic and static wear leveling. I think it's a very nice, easy to understand way, which helps you, you know, you design your product and make it more reliable. Thanks so much, John. It was nice having you here.
Thank you.
And yeah, see you soon, everybody, and have a great day. Thank you. Bye-bye.